Hi, I'd like to welcome you all to the first of the Pearson lectures for the spring semester. Our speaker today will be Professor Jim Hill, who is one of our own faculty members. Jim got his bachelor's degree in 1990 from the State University of New York at Albany. Previously, he had studied at Rensselaer Polytechnic. He received his PhD in 1995 from the University of Pennsylvania, which, by the way, for those curious, is not Penn State University. He goes to great lengths to tell us this. After that, he was a research associate at Stony Brook, where he spent most of his time actually in Japan on a fellowship from the Japanese Physical Society studying neutrino oscillations there. An interesting story about Jim that I don't know if he wants me to tell, but I'm going to say it. Yeah, he didn't actually write it down here. I'm going to tell it anyway. I first became aware of Jim Hill early in the 1990s, I guess, or
95.
About 95 or so. I had never met him, had not met Jim until I came here in 2005. But I had heard of him before that because he was on a very famous experiment that took place in Los Alamos at the Los Alamos National Laboratory. It was called LSND, which I'm imagining you'll tell us something about, at least the name, I don't remember, something like large-scale neutrino detector or something like that, or he'll let us know, where they were looking for some type of effect. Now, at the time, everybody thought that the neutrino had no mass at all. At least we'd never measured one. There's no reason to think that it didn't. We just hadn't measured one before. So one of the things that we do in physics is try to probe the limits of these theories. So we go out to try and measure it. Well, this collaboration went out and they published a paper in Physical Review Letters, I think it was, where the whole collaboration of some 30 to 50 people, I don't remember the exact number, came out and said, we found an effect. And this was a big deal because it would have been the first time that anyone had really stuck their necks out that far and said, look, we got something. Immediately after that paper in Physical Review Letters was another paper by James E. Hill, saying, well, maybe that's not what we've got in this data. Okay, now Jim at the time was a graduate student on this particular experiment, actually getting his thesis from this, I believe. And basically what he did is thumb his nose at the entire collaboration. This, you look at and say, this is a guy who is never going to get a job in this field in his life. Clearly, he has proven us all wrong. He's here now. He spent 5 years as the chair of this very department, so one can argue, yeah, he has succeeded beyond that, let's call it an auspicious start. And today he's going to tell us about a new line of research that he's starting with collaborators of his in South Korea. And I turn the floor to him.
Hi, as mentioned, I'm Jim Hill from our physics department right here at Dominguez Hills. And this talk is on the RENO experiment. I'll tell you what that stands for in just a moment. And the subtitle, A New Angle on Neutrino Oscillations. The angle thing is both literal and figurative. It's a new angle, as in a new way to study it, and there's really something that's an angle involved. Experiment's at a reactor, and that's an artist's rendering of the reactor that it's at. In South Korea, that map, I'll show you something like it again. It shows you exactly where in South Korea this experiment is. Seoul is up, way up there. This is down, out in the boonies, actually. The experiment's just finishing being built, and this picture is distinct for two reasons from the other. Not only is it a picture of the experiment itself, but this one's from my camera. When I was visiting there in January. And I'm going to talk mostly about the experiment in general and the physics behind it in general, but also a little about the visit to the experiment, because that's part of the point here. And for the physics and math crowds, we are going to do a little bit of math in the end. And I shrunk that down really tiny to accent the fact that it's just a little bit. So RENO stands for the Reactor Experiment for Neutrino Oscillations. This is a Google Earth picture of that reactor. And I've got that again later. And I'm going to talk about a little bit about mapping in Google Earth and what you can see and what you can learn here. It's pretty interesting. It's hard to get good information on nuclear reactors because they're considered sensitive and security risks and things like that. You can't take photos on the site. But Google Earth's satellite photos, unlike military bases in the US and certain other countries, are not mosaiced out. So you can see this level of detail, and a little more, actually. On the subject of acronyms and neutrino experiments, somebody mentioned my thesis experiment, LSND. It was the liquid scintillator neutrino detector. But there were other versions of what that stood for before. I'm going to mention very quickly some of the history of experiments in the field a little later. The Reno collaboration, I stole this slide from my friend who's a spokesman. And this slide shows 13 institutions and 40 physicists. All but a couple are in South Korea. The leading university is Seoul National University. That's the biggest university in Korea, most famous. There are a couple of institutes in Russia that are involved, some people who did early calculations for the experiment. But except for the couple of Russians who are not as involved anymore, we're the first international collaborators. And first, not just only, because there is a group in Sweden or somewhere that's talking about joining now as well, and there may be other groups joining as we go on. I said I was going to talk about physics. And with the physics, you got to know what's the problem. And of course, just like in your physics classes, when I say problem, I don't mean trouble. I mean, what problem are we working on? This serves as a mini table of contents for this section of the talk. So the first thing you got to know is, what is a neutrino? And it was neutrino oscillations. What are oscillations? Once you find out what that is, how the heck do you study that? And what do we know about it now? If it turns out we know a lot now, which we do, what's left to do? You know, what's going to be studied at this experiment that wasn't studied at previous experiments? So I've got a couple more slides like that that come through the talk that are mini table of contents for what's coming on. This, what's a neutrino? A lot of history. In the 1930s, people studying beta decay, and they'd been studying it for some years, thought that beta decay at first was just an electron popping out of a neutron and leaving a proton. But they didn't really think of it that way because they hadn't discovered the neutron. They thought it was an electron popping out of a nucleus. And it kind of made sense. But when they studied in detail, they found out that the details of the energy had problems with that idea. Basically, if you got two things popping apart, like a wheel breaking with the hubcap falling off, or a firecracker that only breaks into two pieces, there's only one way you can break into two pieces. You can do it at a bunch of angles, but basically, there's one way to do it. And some of your energy goes here and some goes there, but you don't have choice. When they studied the spectrum, the energy that these beta particles, which are electrons, had in detail, they found that there were all sorts of choices. It didn't look like there were only two pieces. It actually made sense if there was a third piece coming out at the same time. But since you're measuring electrons and you're measuring what's left, you know that that third piece isn't very big or else you would see it. And you know that it's electrically neutral or else you would see it other ways. So it was small and neutral, and they hadn't discovered it yet, but they named it the neutrino. This was in 1932, the same time that the neutron was actually experimentally discovered. Experimental discovery of the neutrino didn't happen for a couple of decades after that. And this is a picture of the discovery experiment with the really young guy, Fred Reines, leaning over their detector. Fred Reines, at the time, was in the Midwest, but ended up being at UC Irvine, and he was a collaborator of ours on experiments we worked on in the 90s, just before he passed away. Mid-50s, they experimentally discover it. By the late 50s, someone had brought up the idea, maybe neutrinos change back and forth. And the idea that came up in 57 was every particle has an antiparticle. Maybe neutrinos, since they're neutral, can change back and forth between particle and antiparticle. And it was a theorist's idea that had very little reason for expecting it to happen. And it was, frankly, pretty much ignored for a long time, that idea. But in the early 60s, they discovered a second type of neutrino and proved it was different from the first. They called it the muon-type neutrino, or as we write it, the Greek letter nu with a subscript of mu, muon neutrino. By the end of the 70s, they had not experimentally verified it, but they knew there must be a third one, which they called the tau-type neutrino, or nu tau. Doesn't really matter much here for this talk how those come about or how they interact, but there are three types. That's important. Okay. In the 60s, when people were discovering all sorts of other things about neutrinos and all sorts of other things about particles, the idea of oscillation seemed like it might be a useful idea to explain a couple of results, or at least one result in the 60s and more results in the 70s. But this time, the oscillations would be not between particle and antiparticle, but between one of these types and another type. And in particular, the original type, which we call electron neutrinos, seemed to be disappearing when we looked for neutrinos from the sun. So maybe they were changing into another kind that we couldn't see easily with the same techniques. In 1998, an experiment that Professor Genaser from our department and I were working on at the time, and 150 or so other people, experimentally discovered neutrino oscillations with cosmic rays. It's an interesting history to that, because in the introduction it was mentioned that I didn't discover neutrino oscillations on my thesis experiment when other people thought they did. Our little subfield of particle physics, neutrino oscillations, had a bad reputation for a while because there were a lot of experiments that thought they discovered it. And then a year or two later, they'd say, oh, no, sorry, that was a mistake. I used to joke with someone else on our experiment that he and I were among the only ones who didn't discover them the first time and then did the second time, because the history of the field was tattered with people who discovered them and then had to backtrack. Neutrinos do change type as they travel. And this changing, how it happens, how long it takes in space or in time as they travel, depends on the square of the mass difference. So I take the mass and I square it for two types, and I take the difference, literal difference, subtract one from the other. It also depends on the energy of the neutrinos. And I'll actually write an equation about that later. But it depends on those two things, how massive they are and how much energy. For the physics majors, I'm going way outside of what the general education people will get. Don't worry about it. This is a quantum mechanical effect. And basically, the point is, when neutrinos are created or detected, they're nu e, nu mu, or nu tau. Right? They correspond to the same particle types as the charged things that you would see. When they travel, they travel with a definite mass, and we call them nu 1, nu 2, and nu 3. And you can change back and forth between those two things, those two bases, if you remember quantum mechanics for those people, with some matrix. And the M stands for matrix here, but it's got mass buried in it. Part of the point of the formalism that I didn't write out is that if you look at that matrix, it's got the masses of the different ones, and that's important because nu 1, nu 2, and nu 3 correspond to different masses. But it's also got all these other numbers, but I can break it up into something that looks like a rotation about one axis, rotation about another axis, and a rotation about a third axis. Just like when you take vectors and you rotate them in space. One difference, one big difference, there's this complex number hanging out here, a purely quantum mechanical effect. I'll say just a couple more words about that later, but not much. this is why I call these things angles, because those little C's and S's, they aren't just numbers. They're cosine of something and sine of the same thing. And they correspond to positions in this matrix. Okay. So you got this weird quantum mechanical effects going on, things changing from one type to another. How do you study that? 1996, the detector that made the 1998 discovery, it's called Super Kamiokande. It's this 50,000-ton tank of water buried, it's an arrow there, under a mountain, a kilometer underground at its closest. Okay. It needs to be underground because these neutrinos don't interact very much, and you want to shield against everything else that comes down, all sorts of stuff coming from the sky. It needs to be big because they don't interact very much. And unless you have a big target, you're not going to find any. They get a dozen events a day from these cosmic rays that are good, clean events, and a dozen that are good, clean events from the sun in 50,000 tons. It needs to be big. It also, besides the cosmic rays and the sun, it also got neutrinos from an accelerator in a different experiment we called K2K. K, the first K is for KK, the accelerator lab name. 2 was being cute, because the neutrinos would go from KK to super K, we called it. And at that accelerator experiment, we verified what was seen in the cosmic rays. So we did a real experiment to show that what we made our observation of was correct and real. This year, we're going to start this Reno experiment. It's a different group. There's a couple of us in common. The detectors are relatively small. I'll tell you just how big later. The source is quite different. It's not cosmic rays. It's not accelerators. It's not the sun. But what we do is we look at neutrinos from this source in one detector and then another detector. And if they're really changing type as they travel, we should measure different things in the two detectors, even though they're the same. This source, you might be able to guess by that little icon, it's a nuclear power plant. And if you couldn't guess by the icon, you might have remembered from the cover slide. The neutrinos come out, and we measure them. What do we know about this effect? I put this slide in here particularly because it's big and ugly and mean looking. I think it accomplishes that, right? People have been studying this stuff for years. There's all sorts of labels on here, super K, Minos, Snow, Camland, super K, LSND, Nomad, Chorus, CNSW, lots and lots of experimental data over decades studying different things. This graph, way more information than I care to talk about. I wanted to make the point there's lots and lots of information out there. Furthermore, this graph is looking at different types of experiments. Some are looking at transitions between two of the three types, and some are looking at other two. Some of them are looking in one range, other ones are looking in other ranges. Some of them give us limits saying, nope, ain't happening here. Some of them are saying, oh, yep, we see it happens right there. A lot of information, huge amounts. The bottom axis on this graph says tan squared theta. Remember I said there were angles? Those angles in the matrix. Usually you don't want to try to plot the angle itself. You plot either the square or the sine or the tangent or something like that, depending on your experiment. I said it also depends on the difference, delta, of mass squared. So that's the two axes of this plot. And each one of those curves has some meaning, very little of which we'll talk about. But the 1998 discovery told us definitely, especially with verification and then refined measurement by this other experiment called Minos, that the mixing between two of the types, nu mu and nu tau, happens. And it happens with a certain value of theta corresponding to that tan squared theta and a certain value of delta m squared, difference in square of mass. Okay. In 2001, a few experiments together had settled the so-called solar neutrino problem looking at neutrinos from the sun. And they told us about another pair. And notice what I wrote here. I wrote nu e. That's one of the ones I talked about. And I wrote nu question mark. We're pretty sure we know what the question mark is. But the point was, all we saw was there weren't enough nu e's. They were disappearing. They're changing into something else. So the experiment doesn't directly tell us what they change into. We have a good idea. We can put information together. But I wanted to be honest. So at that point, then, we note 2 out of 3 angles in that matrix. We note 2 out of the 3 mass splittings, we call it, the delta m squared parts. Okay. So again, one of those pieces of information comes from studying solar neutrinos and, in fact, Camland studied reactor neutrinos. Another one comes from this 1998 discovery and further accelerator experiments. So those are the 2 points in here that are interesting. I'm not going to show you that graph again, so don't worry that it's a big, ugly mess. Okay, we know this stuff. What are we going to look at? Right? What's left to study? Now, if there's 2 out of 3, guess. The third mass splitting, don't need to study that, really. Because you know what? If there are differences, if you got 3 things, and I know the difference between these two, and I know the difference between these two, I can tell you what the difference between the other two is. Right? This is arithmetic. In some sense, it's kind of funny because it's very deep in the physics level, but it's fourth grade math. I got 3 things. I know the difference between 2 of them is some number. The difference between between 2 other ones, a different pair, is some other number. I can find out what the third difference is. Okay. So that we don't need to study. We know what it is. But the third angle, we don't know much about. Some of those experiments that were plotted on there were actually looking to try to find that third angle and didn't find it. So there are some constraints. We know it's not certain values, okay, but we don't know what it is. That complex phase, the thing I said, there's this funny term in that matrix when I break it up that doesn't look like a sine or a cosine. We don't know anything about it. We really know almost nothing about it. And the experiment I'm going to talk about won't tell us anything about it, at least not from its initial running. So it's a complete mystery now, and it will be for years. In our experiment, when we look for that other angle, I stole plots here where we plot the square of sine of an angle. I know you can't read these perfectly well, but we plot something about that angle and something about the delta m squared. They look a little bit like the other plots, right? We have a target range where we know the value of the delta m squared is because we know the differences of the other two, right? And furthermore, it's actually, in some sense, a little easier because one of those mass differences that we know is 30 times bigger than the other one. So one's a couple of really small numbers, and then we got a big number, probably. It could be 2 big numbers and a small number. But whatever it is, 2 of these things are nearly the same, and this one is well constrained. So we know we have to look in that range. And the claim is that in our experiment, when we do it, after taking 3 years of data and doing all of our analysis, if that angle is within the range we can detect it down to some level here. And the different curves correspond to how well we might understand our reactors. And we think we understand them well, but you got to be honest and say, well, if we don't understand them as well as we think they do, we do, what's going to happen? The scale here, again, I know you can't read it, but that says 0.035. If the angle is bigger than 0.035, we will discover it. We will make a real measurement. If it's not that big, we can still have useful input to physics by saying, well, we know it's smaller than something. That we can get a much better limit on in the standard way we do physics, and that's about 0.02. Again, the physics majors are probably following that at some level. But the point is, we can get more knowledge. And there's 2 things that might happen. We might discover something, or we might put a limit, because you don't do the experiment as real research unless you really don't know the answer yet. So that's what we're going to do. Another mini table of contents slide. I'll say a few words about what kind of tools we use to do these kinds of experiments. talk about the idea of a two-detector experiment. I mentioned there are two detectors. I won't really give you right away a straw man design, but I'll talk about what goes into it. Straw man design means sort of like back of the envelope calculation. If I had just do this quickly on a piece of paper, what's it going to look like? A few words about reality. Actually doing the experiment is different than making notes on paper. Then one slide about what other experiments are doing, because we're not the only ones who want to know this. And then some words about our detectors. Oops. So nuclear reactors give neutrinos of a type that we know. We know exactly what they are, and we know really well what the energy distribution is. Okay. Particle accelerators give neutrinos with, depending on the accelerator, maybe 1,000 times more energy. Can be less, can be a lot more. When you make a detector, you have to optimize for what kind of source you're going to use. We're going to use reactors, lower energy. And we're going to look at an experiment with two detectors, one close, one far. Same slide as before. And what we're looking to measure is at the close detector, we measure a lot of neutrinos. We measure how many are really produced. At the far detector, we're missing some. If we make these detectors look just the same, then we can be pretty sure that they're really missing. Not, we made a mistake. The math turns into a fairly ugly expression, and even this is an approximation, working out those matrices, but we know this term, and we know it's really, really close to one. We know this term. Or sorry, we don't know the first, but we know it's close to one. We know that second term very well, and it's very close to one. This sine squared 2 theta 1 3, that's what we're looking for. The distances between detector and source and the energies of the neutrinos, well, those are fixed when you build the thing. The delta m squareds, those are facts of nature. And delta m squared 1, 2 is a really, really tiny number. That's one of the numbers we know. If it's a tiny number, sine squared of it is even tinier. And this turns out to be not so important. So we're looking at this last term, which has a number that's nearly 1, or sorry, a number we want to know, and these physics and experiment parameters. Okay, more about that as we go on. If we're gonna actually build this thing, reactors, we not only know a lot about, we can find. They exist. We don't have to build a reactor. This idea of parasitic running, it means we get our source for free. We just have to find someone who will let us put our experiment next to their reactor. We need two precision detectors, and we want them to match because we don't want to have possible error, and I mean error, not mistake, right? Between them. We're going to measure the same kind of thing that was measured in the discovery of the neutrino. So it's a similar detector, actually, just a lot more precise. And we want to choose our distances to maximize that effect that I just showed, that curve. We want to get that after there's been some real loss. In the equation that I showed you that I just talked about a lot, that term inside the sine square was delta m squared L over E. Well, delta m squared is a fact of nature. We think we know it pretty well. E, the energy, it's basically facts of nature and the way reactors work, what kind of fuel we put in them, how that fuel decays. Okay, so those are things we can't do much about. The distance, the L, we want to choose that appropriately, and that turns out to be a big key and a big difference between our experiment and some of the competitors. We really want our error to be less than 1%. Otherwise, we won't get the precise measurement that I talked about, the limits. Turns out knowing the distances to a nuclear reactor is not as simple as it sounds. In our experiment, from where we have our close detector to the reactors, is about 290 meters. Of course, the reactors aren't all in one place. You can see there's a bunch of dots there. There's six of them. This whole thing is what's on that line. The distance across this is over a kilometer. So there's a bunch of distances. You know, you can calculate it, you know. The distance from the center line or the reactors out to the far detector is about a kilometer and a third. If you want to know where the center of a nuclear reactor is to like within tens of centimeters, you got to ask the people who own it. And you know what? They aren't allowed to tell you. It's a security risk thing. I was talking to a lot of friends in geography about this recently. It's kind of funny. It reminds us that some of the history of map making and some of the things you don't think about when you look at Google Earth, it's military, right? Map making, a lot of it really got strong in Europe when they had map making for military purposes. It's nice to know where the other guy's got his troops, where he's got his fields, where he's got his cannons, where he's got his nuclear reactors. The other thing that I'll mention a little bit about, next to every reactor, they take the old fuel and they throw it in a bucket of water for a while. They call them spent fuel pools. Knowing where those are, same type of problem, same security issues. We will get this information, but it turns out there's a huge number of political hoops to jump through. And we won't be able to publish it. We'll just be able to publish results based on it. The detectors are still underground because we still have those cosmic ray things coming through. How much ground are they under? Well, you go with what you got. This hill was 70 meters high, so that's how much shielding we got. This hill was 200 meters high, so that's how much shielding we got. It might have been nice if this was just a little further back. It costs a lot of money to dig a hole. And the balance of the money it costs to dig this tunnel and the physics gain you would get didn't justify putting it further back in the hill. So that's the kind of reality you got to face when you actually build an experiment. Then I keep saying detectors, precision detectors. Neutrinos, and they're actually anti-neutrinos. That's what the bar is for. When they interact, they produce a positron, an electron plus, and a neutron. You'd like to see both of those things. This is something that the discovery experiment could not do, could not see both of those things. But if you see both, then you really know it was a neutrino. You'd like to measure the total energy really precisely. We can do that better than the 50-year-old experiment, of course. But liquid scintillator, like on my thesis experiment, like what we're using here, measures energy well. On my thesis experiment, it was very, very dilute, not much light from it. Here, it's a lot of light from charged particles. We put something called gadolinium. It's a metal you don't find very much, but it captures neutrons really, really well. And when it captures them, it gives off gamma rays, so we know about where the neutrons are. You need a pretty big volume. I said before this was small, and I still haven't told you how small or how big. But you need a fair-sized volume, and you need some significant shielding. Already talked about how we got it under 70 meters or a couple hundred meters of rock to get the shielding. The volume, give you a picture in a while. These other experiments, one in France called Double Show, double because they also use two detectors. There's another one in China called Daya Bay. That's the place where it is. Honestly, we're better. The French one has a pair of reactors instead of a half dozen reactors. So the source is weaker, and the far detector is closer. So there's not as big an effect. In fact, I didn't write it in the slide, but the near detector is actually farther. So the difference in effect between near and far is a lot more subtle. And I've got the numbers if someone wants to ask later. I didn't write them in here. The Chinese experiment, they may actually have some advantages, but they aren't going to be built for a couple more years. We're going to be running within weeks or maybe a month. Also, the detectors in the Chinese experiment aren't identical. I don't know why they chose to do that. It does save cost, but it increases some errors you might encounter. Again, errors, not mistakes. Our detector looks a little complicated. It's not super complicated. This is, I need to spend some time on. Here's what we call the target. It's 16 tons. So tiny compared to the thing I was talking about before, 50,000 tons. 16 tons, kind of a lot for what most of you would want to carry around, right? It's got liquid scintillator Very strong liquid scintillator. It says, if you can see this closely, LAB. It's the name of the chemical that is the liquid scintillator. It stands for linear alkyl benzene. I don't really know what it is either. I've read about it. And gadolinium, GD. GD stands for gadolinium. Remember that next time someone says GD to you. That's where we want to look at the events. Outside of that is a region we refer to as the gamma catcher. Still liquid scintillator, no gadolinium. When gamma rays from neutron capture on the gadolinium move, they'll move macroscopic distances like this. Okay. You want to see that light, so you need a much bigger vessel to contain all that. That's what the gamma catcher does, and that's why it still has liquid scintillator, but we don't want to see the neutrons that get captured in that volume. We'd like to separate the volumes. And remember, the neutrino interactions are going on through the whole thing all the time. You can't stop them from happening all over. Outside of the gamma catcher, there's this area we call a buffer tank, which has mineral oil, which almost doesn't scintillate, but we can see exiting particles or entering particles in that. And outside of that, finally, what we call the Vito region full of water. What that's mainly for is there's some cosmic rays that actually get through that mountain and go straight down through the whole thing. Yes, I zipped across here because that's what they do. And it's easy to see them crossing in your detector, but you'd like to know more information about exactly where they crossed, because there's things that happen after they've crossed that are still relevant. The sizes are written here. 16.5 tons is the important size. But you can see it's scaled. It's like one of those Russian doll things. Right? So now that you know this is so great, you want to hear more about it, right? Right? Oh, yeah, question.
Yeah, how do you know, is this question time?
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, okay. How do you know which reactor that the neutrino is coming from?
So the question was, how do we know which reactor the neutrino comes from? The answer is we don't. We only know the total. In our calculations, and we know how well matched these reactors are, they aren't exactly the same, but we know how different they are. In our calculations, we can account for what we expect for each one. But we only see a total. In our near detector, we'll be seeing more than 1,000 a day. In our far detector, 100-ish a day. And one of the things that will give us good information on how well we understand that difference is when the reactors go down for refueling. They'll suddenly, they don't stop producing, but they'll suddenly only be producing like a percent as many neutrinos as before. So that'll help us get through that information. And the single detector experiments that went before really gave us good ways to understand how to calculate and analyze that.
Different distances,
and we know them all equally well. Right now, the detector is almost done. In fact, within a couple weeks, it'll be complete, and then we have to put the liquid scintillator in. The reactors, well, we understand reactors very well. I keep telling you that, but it needs work, and I'll say more about that later. We have to model the detector in detail. That's always important for any kind of experiment. And we need to study the backgrounds we might have. What else happens that'll confound our ability to understand these events? Here's a melange of pictures that I took in January when I was in Korea. This one, it looks like big steel plates painted green. You know what it is? It's big steel plates painted green. It's the top of the near detector, which was actually completely constructed. And that's the actual top that they're going to put on top of it. It's on now. That near detector, done with. This is a picture of a bunch of little dots you see here that look kind of like cells or something on there. Those are the light detectors inside of one of our detectors, photomultiplier tubes. It's at the far detector. It was lifted up from the buffer region. And I was looking at that. Over here is someone working on the detector. The place where he's sitting all covered in plastic there. That's what houses the buffer region. The bigger circle is the veto region. This other picture of the same thing, basically, I backed up and took another picture. I put in because you can't see what's on those computer screens from here, but I can tell you that what's on there is we're actually able to read out the electronics and make graphs of how the individual electronics channels behave to test that the equipment isn't totally screwed up. So we're working on understanding all of the electronics, and all this stuff is almost together. And I took these pictures about a month ago. So it's a little further along now. The reactors, because it looks like I'm going to be doing some work on understanding that, people have been studying for years. Nuclear engineers know a lot about what happens in a reactor, way more than I appreciated before I started looking into this experiment. The experiments that went before us and used one detector, they relied on knowing the reactor really well. Back in December, a couple of months ago, somebody published an article in a prestigious journal that said, you know what, maybe all those calculations are wrong by a few percent. Up to a few percent. That would be a disaster for those old experiments. But if you got two detectors, being wrong by an overall few percent doesn't matter. Having the spectrum shape wrong matters a little bit, but not very much. So two detector experiments are critical. And in fact, the other two experiments I talked about, Double Show, Dia Bay, plus our experiment, Reno, all use two detectors. Because we all know that you have to do that to get the level of precision we need. Mentioned about the distances and getting the information. Besides having government hoops to jump through, there's another issue, the spent fuel issue. Those pools are big. Where each piece of spent fuel, each fuel rod, they call them, is actually matters. And in Korea, it's a harder problem than in France. Because in France, there's a lot of nuclear waste dumps, and they keep stuff in the spent fuel pools for 5 years, and then they send it to a real nuclear waste dump. In Korea, there are no nuclear waste dumps. They leave them there, and some of them have been there for almost 30 years. And there are things that we have to track for 30 years. So it's a percentage effect that we know fairly well, but we'll have to understand that really well by the time we do our final analysis. And that's tricky business about finding locations, as well as tracking what goes on in these nuclear reactions for 30 years. Detector modeling, well, any particle nuclear experiment, I could have said pretty much any physics experiment. There's a whole group within a collaboration that just does that. Liquid scintillator, in particular, but scintillator in general, notoriously hard to get right. And liquid scintillators, some of them are proprietary. The people who make them won't tell you some of the details. You have to measure all sorts of stuff to write your model. It's okay. We can do it, but it's a lot of work. The complexity of the structure, having this nested Russian doll with the big photomultiplier tubes, light detectors at each piece, that's not intellectually deep, but it makes for a lot of work in building the computer code for the models. So there's a lot to do. backgrounds being studied, the detectors are the same. We've been measuring a lot of things in detail, like filling them up with water to make sure they were really exactly the same size. But the backgrounds are not exactly the same. Anything from the detector itself is going to be the same. But anything from the floor will be the same, but coming from the sky, you get more shielding at one than you have at the other. And it's good. You want more shielding, especially in the detector with less events, but it makes the background different. And if it's different, we need to study it. And again, it's pretty well understood. It shouldn't be a conceptually difficult problem for us, but it's another big task that needs to be done. If I had extra time and have questions, I can tell a little bit about the study of the rock, because in digging those tunnels, we actually had core samples taken, core samples at other places in the mountains. So we understand the rock and how much radioactivity is in the rock pretty well. pretty well. So this what will we do does not imply we the Reno collaboration, but we Dominguez Hills. Documentation and outreach is actually something that when I got involved with this, I said I'd like to jump into because I can contribute right away. Remember the list of collaborators? I'm the only native English speaker on the experiment now. So I can help out with some things just because of that. Of course, doing real work. When I went there in January, didn't get a lot of time to help, but I actually had my hands on stuff in the detector just like everyone else, and I'm going to have my hands on computer stuff just like everyone else. The particular computer stuff that I'm going to be working on is the flux calculation, how many of these neutrinos are coming. Helping supervise students, which, of course, we do that all the time. I'll say a word or two about that, because it does mean something different here. For the documentation and outreach, actually this talk is kind of a step for me because it's my first talk on the experiment, really excited about the experiment, but I'm hoping that I can change it into a seminar I can use for particle physics groups, which would be a different talk, but hopefully go give a few more talks, drum up some more interest in the experiment throughout the community of particle physicists, nuclear physicists. When the experiments start up, whenever you start a big experiment, you have a press release. And it's, in some sense, not a big deal because, you know, it's scientists writing press releases. But I'm actually helping with that, helping try to make it better. I've looked at the one from the French experiment, which has a lot of American collaborators. And frankly, we can write a better one. And I think I've got to start on it, improving that. Internal documentation. When there are more international collaborators, you need to review the English because, frankly, you know, people using second language are going to use some words that are subtle in wrong ways, and you want somebody to review all of it. It really is a serious task in an experiment, making your documentation smooth enough so that everyone can read it. And giving more talks will be a big thing for the experiment. So in the real work, as I said, I started in January doing stuff, and I have to very strongly say thanks to Dominguez Hills Academic Affairs Office. The provost's office is the one that had the money for this. It wasn't from a regular research grant. It was money from Academic Affairs. So I strongly want to say thank you for that because it's a little bit of support they're giving for real research, which we don't always get enough of. And this time they really came through for us. Have been semi-regularly teleconferencing with the colleagues in Korea to talk about what more we can do, what we're getting done, keeping up on things. The web has made life for international collaborations a lot better. And I've been starting to look through some of the actual stuff that's being done in the, quote, beam calculation group, or flux calculation, I say sometimes, calculating how much we expect. To do that improvement, I already mentioned that recently, calculations other people have done say we're a little wrong with what we've been doing. I mentioned about the locations. We need to get both of those things right. There's a Korean student who has gotten himself stuck having to deal with all the government hoops to jump through to get the data on exactly where the center of each reactor is. And his next task after that will be finding out where those spent fuel pools are. And it's a big job for him. But once he gets that, we have to put that into our models and use it. The flux in those spent fuel pools is percentage of the total, but we're looking for percentage error, so we better get it right. When we supervise students, I don't just mean at Dominguez Hills. I've got a student who's sitting right in front of me practically who's going to be doing some work on this this semester, and somebody else who may be doing a little bit. Also, though, in Korea, especially at Seoul National, sometimes the students write their theses in English and they really want someone to review it. And this can be a really big job. We've done this before. Professor Gneiser actually did a lot of work on a previous experiment we worked on, helping review the English in a foreign student's thesis. And you really have to know what's going on, not just the English itself, but you have to know all the physics to be able to see whether this needs to be corrected or see how it needs to be corrected. So that will turn into a fair-sized task, actually, as things go on. Oops. Ah, sorry. The clicker clicked past me. Our group at Dominguez Hills has actually done this a lot. I mentioned Professor Gneiser did this for a Korean student on another experiment. When I lived at the lab in Japan, I used to do this regularly for the students who worked at the lab with me. And it's something that, besides being a big job and an important job and a job that helps us learn, it is appreciated within the collaboration. So I think that's going to be a big deal, having our students participate in this will be a big deal for the university. It'll be a big deal for the experiment because they'll have more people to do some of the work. And they'll be able to say they've got international students collaborating, which is a big deal in Korea. Hey, why does it click past? I brought a couple more slides to answer potential questions people have. But this has been basically an overview of what goes on. I've got a lot more detail sitting around on disk if people want to talk about it more. But that'll close me out for the formal talk. So first, thank you. And then somebody got questions you want to?
This is one quick question. The angle you mentioned, is that the angle of the axis of rotation of the neutrino?
This matrix behaves just like a rotation. But it's not rotating in space. It's not doing this and this. It's changing types. And that's actually a big point. Oscillation here doesn't mean swinging back and forth. It means changing types. And the angle means the difference between two types.
Flavor space.
Well, converting from flavor space to mass space.
Yeah.
Yeah. The comment was that we call it flavor space, and you can think about it like vanilla, chocolate, and strawberry. Another classic example people use in math classes when they talk about this kind of problem is if I own a taxi cab company, I can look at taxi cabs in terms of where I want them to start their shift, so there are the right number at the airport, the right number downtown, and the right number in the suburbs. Or I can look at them in terms of older cars, newer cars, and really ancient pieces of junk. And one of those ways of looking at it is good for finding out things on a time scale of the day, where you want them to go. The other one is useful for the time scale of how many months you expect before you have to send them to the garage. And you can convert between the two. And it acts a lot like a rotation. And in that analogy, the angle would be sort of like the cosine of the angle would be like how many of the cabs in the suburbs are real old junkers. That'd tell you something about that.
It comes down to like symmetry operations and like.
It's exactly symmetry operations. And for the physics major crowd, this is not a real rotation is an SO3 symmetry, and this is an SU2 symmetry, and the difference between the two is that complex phase part. But it's the part we aren't going to study and don't know anything about. Other experiments will. Some data from this experiment, if we run longer, might be able to address it, but only in a different kind of analysis that I didn't talk about. So.